Welcome to the first lecture in a series of MubTech videos about the immune system. This first movie is a 15-minute crash course in adaptive immunity, covering T cells and B cells, the two main players in the adaptive immune system. Generally, depending on the T cell, it can kill, help, or suppress other cells. B cells, on the other hand, produce antibodies that can neutralize pathogens. T cells and B cells are both lymphocytes. All blood cells arise in the bone marrow from common blood-forming stem cells called the hematopoietic stem cells. Following the right arm in this image, all lymphocytes have a common lymphoid progenitor cell, and under it we find the T and B cells. The lymphocytes grow and are deployed through the lymphoid organs. These are divided into central organs, comprising the bone marrow and the thymus, and peripheral organs, which are made up of different kinds of lymph nodes and other aggregates of lymphoid tissue. So, the blood-forming stem cells reside in the bone marrow and differentiate into, in this case, pre-B and pre-T cells. The pre-T cells migrate to the thymus, where they develop their TCRs, the T cell receptors. The pre-B cells, on the other hand, stay in the bone marrow until their BCRs, the B cell receptors, are ready and tested for autoimmunity. When the T and B cells are fully developed, they are allowed to migrate out into the peripheral lymph nodes, where they can stumble upon antigen-presenting cells that activate them. The first step in the activation of a naive T cell is the binding to cognate antigen, an MHC molecule, on an antigen-presenting cell. The cell then starts to produce the cytokine IL-2, primarily to juice itself up, after which it divides into several copies of the very same clone. After clonal expansion, the cells differentiate and then migrate to the periphery with all systems go, ready to perform their effector functions. Here's a fun fact. The T in T cell comes from the fact that T cells mature in the thymus. The activation of a B cell starts with its B cell receptor recognizing a pathogen. By engulfing the pathogen and chopping it into pieces, the B cell can then present peptides of the pathogen on its MHC class II. Simultaneously, a naive T cell is activated by a dendritic cell to become a follicular helper T cell. And as seen, since the helper T cell recognizes the same pathogen as the B cell, if the T and B cells are present in the same lymph node, the T cell is able to also recognize the peptide that the B cell is presenting. This phenomenon is called linked recognition. The follicular helper T cell is able to fully activate the B cell. The activated B cell then proliferates and differentiates into antibody-secreting plasma cells. With additional help from T cells, some B cells stay in the lymph node and class switch, meaning they replace their IgM antibodies for antibodies of another isotype, for example IgG. Some B cells will also fine-tune the affinity of their antibodies through somatic hypermutation. This process is called affinity maturation, and results in B cells coming out to battle the pathogen with really sharp weapons. Finally, memory B cells are also formed, which are extremely long-lived and have a low activation threshold. The B in B cells comes from the bursa of Fabricius organ in birds. This is the organ in birds where B cells were first found. Since B cells develop in the bone marrow in humans, the B is still good though. It's important to understand that T cell receptors and B cell receptors are not directed versus pathogens per se. Rather, antigen receptors are randomly assembled, and together they can recognize basically any structure. So, how can they reach such an enormous diversity? Well, first of all, each of the three or four gene segments that together encode the final antigen receptor exists in multiple copies. These copies differ from one another slightly, and only one is chosen for the final receptor. Second, when the three or four gene segments making up a chain are put together, some nucleotides can be added or subtracted from the sequence in between the segments. Finally, different heavy and light chains, or alpha and beta chains in the case of T cells, are combined to form the fully assembled antigen receptor. The B cell receptor, the BCR, can be secreted as an antibody with identical epitope specificity as the original BCR. As seen, each antigen may have several immunodominant epitopes. The word antigen is actually an abbreviation of the phrase antibody generator. Since antigens are also triggering T-cell responses, I guess we have stopped seeing it as an abbreviation. I'd like you to note that the BCR and antibody recognizes the antigen in its native form. Antigen epitopes recognized by T-cells, on the other hand, are often buried within the antigen. Therefore, the protein antigen must first be broken down into peptide fragments by an antigen-presenting cell. Once in fragments, the peptide is loaded onto an MHC molecule within the antigen-presenting cell, shuffled to the cell surface and presented to the T-cell. It's important to note that the T-cell receptor recognizes the combination of peptide and MHC. If the T-cell receptor binds to the correct MHC molecule, showing an incorrect peptide, the T-cell receptor will back off. The same will happen if an antigen-presenting cell shows the correct peptide but on the wrong MHC molecule. This important concept is called MHC restriction. For that first step of antigen recognition to lead to trigger-happy effector cells, the antigen-presenting cell need to provide three kinds of signals. Signal 1 is the binding of MHC molecule plus peptide to the T-cell receptor. But in addition, for the T-cell to survive, the antigen-presenting cell need to provide signal 2 in the form of a co-stimulating CD80/86 binding to CD28 on the T-cell. Finally, signal 3 is different combinations of cytokines that dictates what kind of effector cell the T-cell should become. If there is no pathogen-associated molecular patterns present, if there's no danger signals, the dendritic cell keeps these three signals down low. If the antigen-presenting dendritic cell provides signal 3 in the form of TGF-beta, the CD4-positive T-cell becomes a regulatory T-cell that inhibits other T-cells and dendritic cells. If the dendritic cell produces only IL-6, the T-cell differentiate into T-follicular helper cells that helps B-cells isotype switch and affinity maturate. However, a combination of TGF-beta and IL-6 results in a Th17 cell that helps neutrophils. IL-12 together with interferon gamma gives you a Th1 cell that makes macrophages better at engulfing pathogens. And IL-4 results in Th2 cells that activate cells often involved in allergy, like mast cells and eosinophils. CD8 positive T cells, since they are cytotoxic, meaning that they are cell killers, meaning they are super dangerous if they attack the wrong cell, have an even higher activation threshold. They often need CD4 help in the form of CD40 ligand binding to CD40 on the antigen-presenting cell. And in addition, the CD4 cell produces extra IL-2, which the CD8 likes. Boom, the CD8 T-cell is ready. As said, the cytotoxic cell kills other cells, and it can do so using two pathways. Either it goes for the perforin-granzyme pathway, where perforin and granzyme B is released from vesicles in close proximity of the target cell. Perforin creates a hole in the target cell, which allows the entry of granzymes. Granzyme B subsequently starts a so-called caspase cascade, which final outcome is programmed cell death of the target cell. The other pathway is called the Fas-Fas ligand pathway, in which the Fas ligand on the T-cell binds to a Fas receptor on the target cell. The end result is again programmed cell death, also known as apoptosis. As said earlier, the T-cell receptor recognizes the combination of peptide and MHC. The MHC complex is a collection of genes on chromosome 6. In humans, the gene products of the MHC complex are called human leukocyte antigens, also known as HLA. Different HLA molecules can have different functions, but in terms of antigen presentation, the most important MHC class 1 products are HLA A, B, and C, which are expressed on all nucleated cells. Class 2 products, on the other hand, are only expressed on antigen-presenting cells, so dendritic cells, macrophages and B-cells mostly. And these guys present antigen to CD4-positive helper T-cells. Not only do we have all different HLA, B, C, DP, DR, DQ and so on in each individual, the HLA antigens are also very polymorphic, meaning that, for example, HLA exists in thousands of slightly different versions within the human population. As you might have noticed, antibodies can come in different forms and shapes. To clear it out a little bit, IgG, IgE, and IgD exists in the form of a monomer, meaning that they are a single protein. This is, in at least my mind, the original form, what I think of when I hear the word antibody. But IgA may also exist in dimer form. IgA in this format can be secreted in mucus. Finally, IgM is always a pentamer with five arms. The word antibody, by the way, comes from when people discovered that substances developed in blood could work as an antidote after, for example, a snake bite. Depending on the danger at hand, antibodies may work in three main ways. Toxins or viruses can be neutralized by antibodies. Extracellular bacteria can be opsonized by antibodies. The bacteria are too big to be neutralized, but being covered by antibodies makes them look extra yummy to macrophages. The third main function is to activate the complement system, which makes the pathogen look even more yummy. In addition, the complement system can attract additional macrophages and can even directly destroy the pathogen by disrupting its cell membrane. With the functions of T cells and B cells in mind, here's a general course of an infection. First, you have a penetration of your epithelium. Innate immune cells like macrophages, neutrophils, and dendritic cells recognize general pathogen-associated molecular patterns. And when they do, they start inflammation. This is super important. Without inflammation, the adaptive immune system won't start. Due to inflammatory signals, plasma enters tissue and there's more drainage to the lymph vessels. In the lymph node, antigen is presented to T cells, which becomes activated, and in turn activate B cells that present peptides of the same pathogen. And once ready, the effector lymphocytes migrate to the site of infection. The helper T cells encourage the macrophages to do an even better job, and the B cell secretes antibodies that can neutralize the pathogen. Being biological weapons, lymphocytes must be able to discriminate self from non-self. Newly developed T cell receptors that cannot recognize self MHC molecules are deprived of survival signals and eliminated. The T cells need to be able to recognize the MHC molecules that are used by the antigen-presenting cells in the periphery. So if the T cell recognizes self-MHC, that's good. It's allowed to pass. Next, the T cell should not recognize self-peptides. If the T cell doesn't, good. It's allowed to pass out from the thymus and into the periphery as a free, young, and naive T cell. But if the T cell does recognize a self-peptide and bind to it hard, then, sorry, it must be eliminated. Alternatively, if it's really lucky, it could become a regulatory T cell that can stop potentially autoreactive siblings in the periphery. The selection in the thymus is not 100% perfect, which is why there are ways to stop autoreactive cells also in peripheral lymphoid organs. Peripheral T cell tolerance is induced when T cells are activated without the presence of any inflammation. Since dendritic cells constitutively produce TGF-beta, the potentially autoreactive T cells might instead become a regulatory T cell specific for the self antigen. The B cells in the bone marrow just need to not react to self peptides. If the B cell doesn't, good. It's allowed to pass and enjoy life as a naive B cell. If the B cell does bind, it receives signals to commit suicide. Sorry. If some autoreactive B cells slip through the filter, don't worry. Remember that B cells need T cell help to become fully activated. If there is no T cell out there with a receptor for the same self antigen, then there will be no follicular helper cell to activate the B cell. Lastly, let's talk a bit about immunological memory. In the case of the B cell, the improved secondary reaction is caused by a change in the receptor. For example, as seen after the first immunization, there is a higher concentration of IgM. But as the B cell clone class switches to IgG, with time, this isotype takes over. Likewise, the process of affinity maturation causes the later emerging plasma cells to secrete IgG with higher affinity for the antigen. In contrast, the improved T cell memory response is caused by changes in the cell. For example, the virus-specific T cell clone still has an identical receptor, but the frequency of the clone will stay amplified, also well beyond the clearing of the infection. Finally, immunological memory can be very long-lived. Since smallpox has been eradicated, recall responses can be considered true memory of vaccination in the absence of reinfection. In this example, antibody levels show no significant decline, and T-cell memory shows a half-life of 15 years. There have even been reports of smallpox responses still 75 years after vaccination. All right, that's it. Thank you for watching and see you next time.